Hello and welcome to the science class. My name is Teacher John. Today I'm going to take you through Science Primary 5, Term 3. In our previous lesson, we looked at breastfeeding and generally vulnerable groups of people. We said vulnerable groups of people are people whose health can easily be harmed due to poor feeding. We gave examples of vulnerable groups of people. We said pregnant women, breastfeeding mothers, sick people, elderly, and so on. So today we're going to look at breastfeeding mothers. Why should breastfeeding mothers, actually, what foodstuffs should breastfeeding mothers be given? Breastfeeding mothers should be given foods like, majorly fluids, like porridge, milk, fruit juice, and so on. Why should they be given these fluids? Why should they be given a lot of porridge, a lot of milk, a lot of fruit juice? To stimulate milk production. So the question here, why should breastfeeding mothers be given a lot of fluids like milk and porridge to drink? To stimulate milk production. So someone who is breastfeeding should be given a lot of porridge and milk, maybe water and fruit juice, so that they can be able to produce a lot of milk for the baby. Then, next look at weaning. What is weaning? Weaning is the gradual introduction of semi-solid food into a baby's diet. Now, when you say semi-solid food, you're looking at soft food, mashed Irish potatoes. You get Irish potatoes, mix their soup, can be beef soup, chicken soup, fish soup. Then after mixing there, you smash or you mash, you crush into, to make something which is like a semi-solid, very soft. And you give that food to the baby. Remember, these babies don't have the teeth to chew food. That's why we mash for them, to ease digestion. So, and that's what we call weaning. It's the gradual. The word gradual means slowly by slowly. Slowly by slowly. So, weaning is the gradual introduction of semi-solid food into a baby's diet. The baby's diet all along has been breastfeeding or breast milk. So, you're introducing other foodstuffs. And these foodstuffs should be soft, semi-solid. And you introduce them slowly by slowly. That's why we are saying weaning is the gradual introduction of semi-solid food into a baby's diet. Weaning is the gradual introduction of semi-solid food into a baby's diet. We need the gradual introduction of semi-solid food into a baby's diet. And you should know that weaning is done at the age of 6 months, or is done when the child is 6 months. Weaning starts when the child or when the baby in 6 months. Weaning starts when the baby is 6 months. So what's the importance of weaning? What is the importance of weaning babies? Importance of weaning babies. Importance of weaning babies. Importance of weaning babies. One, to prevent anemia. To prevent anemia. Number two, for the baby, to get iron, which is not to breast milk, for the baby to get iron, which is not in breast milk. For the baby to get iron, which is not in breast milk. We can say, for the baby to get iron, which is not in breast milk. So remember, when a baby is born, the baby is given only breast milk for the first 6 months. From the time the baby is born, is given only breast milk, and that is very important. For the first 6 months, babies are fed on only breast milk, and this breast milk does not have iron. The only food value lacking in breast milk is iron. So when the child reaches 6 months and you don't give this child foods rich in iron, the child will start getting anemia because breast milk lacks iron. So we cut out weaning so that the baby can get iron from other foodstuffs, because this iron is not in breast milk. And when you do that, you are preventing anemia. When you feed this child on other foodstuffs rich in iron, you are preventing anemia. That's what we are saying. We cannot mean to prevent anemia or for the baby to get iron, which is not in breast milk. NB. Iron is the only food value. Iron is the only food value lacking in breast milk. Iron is the only food value lacking in breast milk. As simple as that, we may ask you which food value lacks in breast milk. That food value is iron. And we cut out weaning so that babies can get iron, which is not found in breast milk. Then look at sick people. Why should sick people be fed on food rich in proteins? Why should sick people be fed on food rich in proteins? Another question. Why should sick people be be fed on food. Why should sick people be fed on food rich in proteins? Why should sick people be fed on food rich in proteins? Why should sick people be fed on food rich in proteins? One is to replace worn out body cells, to replace worn out body cells. Then number two, to repair worn out body tissues, to repair worn out body tissues. To repair worn out body tissues and to replace worn out body cells, that's why you're supposed to be fed on food rich in proteins. So when you are sick, body cells wear out and body tissues also wear out. So you're supposed to remember, proteins are bodybuilding foods. Proteins help you build the body. So sick people are supposed to be fed on food rich in proteins to repair worn out body tissues and to replace worn out body cells. Then we look at the elderly. Why should the elderly be fed on food rich in proteins? Same answers. Why should the elderly be fed on food rich in proteins? Remember, the elderly are very old people. Very, very old people, they should be fed on food rich in proteins. Why should the elderly? Why should the elderly be fed on food rich in proteins? Why should the elderly be fed on food rich in proteins? Answers remain the same. To replace worn out body cells. To replace worn out. To replace worn out body cells. Then to repair worn out body tissues. To repair worn out body tissues. To repair worn out body tissues. Then another question. Why should the elderly be given soft food or mashed food? Remember, most of the elderly people don't have teeth to chew food. So they are supposed to be given soft food to prevent indigestion and constipation. Another question about the elderly. Why should the elderly be fed on soft food? Why should the elderly be fed on soft food? Why should the elderly be fed on soft food? One is to prevent indigestion. Now, indigestion is a condition whereby the eaten food is unable to be digested. For example, if you eat beans and you don't chew them, you just swallow them, because maybe you don't have teeth. So the food you put in the mouth, you just swallow. That food may not be digested. And it comes out of your body the way it went in. So they come out of the feces when they are still whole. Like if they are beans and you don't chew the beans, you swallow the beans, they will come through feces when they are still beans. That's what's called indigestion. It's a condition when one is unable to digest the food due to poor chewing, or if you don't chew food properly, you may have indigestion. So the elderly people who are very old, like somebody who is 90 years, 100 years, they may not have the teeth to chew food properly. So what you are supposed to do is to give them soft food. When you give them soft food, it helps them to prevent indigestion. Because soft food, even though you swallow, you may not need to chew soft food. You may just swallow and you will not get indigestion because food is already soft. One of the reasons why we chew food is to ease digestion. So if the food is already soft, digestion will still take place. Now, here we are looking at people who are very old, and some of them is 100 years, 105 years. Those people don't have the teeth to chew food. So we give them soft food to prevent indigestion. I thought you should know that. Then, how to care for the elderly? 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 One, by feeding them on a balanced diet, Number two, by taking them for medication in case they are sick, So in case they are sick, you take them to the hospital. Then by helping them do domestic work, by taking them for medication, by feeding them on a balanced diet. These are different ways you can care for the elderly. People who are very old. Then, how do you care for sick people? Now, we can care for sick people in the following ways: by feeding them on a balanced diet. Number two, by taking them to the hospital. Taking them to the hospital. taking them to the hospital. Then number three, even helping them to do domestic work is another way of caring for sick people. You can help them wash clothes, cook food, wash utensils, bathing, you can bathe them. That's how we can care for sick people and the elderly. So you look at malnutritional. Let's look at malnutrition. Malnutrition. So what is malnutrition? Malnutrition is a condition when the body does not have enough food values. And nutrition is a condition. Malnutrition is a condition when the body lacks some food values. Malnutrition is a condition when the body lacks some food values. And when you have this condition called malnutrition, you'll get what you call deficiency diseases or malnutritional diseases. So let's look at malnutritional diseases or deficiency diseases. Malnutritional diseases or deficiency. Malnutritional diseases or deficiency diseases. Now, malnutritional diseases, these are diseases that are caused due to the lack of some food values. These are diseases caused due to lack of some food values. Malnutritional diseases are diseases caused due to lack of some food values. So if you lack some food values, you get malnutritional diseases. For example, we have kwashiorkor, marasmus, and so on. So look at examples of deficiency diseases. Examples of deficiency diseases. Examples of deficiency diseases. One, we have kwashiorkor. Bashako. Number two, we have Marasmus. Number three, we have anemia. Number four, we have goiter. Number five, we have night blindness. Night blindness. Number five, we have scurvy. Number six, we have beriberi. Number seven, we have pellagra. Number eight, we have hemophilia. Those are examples of deficiency diseases. Then we have rickets. Rickets. So we shall look at them one by one. Let's begin by looking at Kwashiorkor. 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 It is caused by lack of proteins. It is caused by lack of proteins in the body or in the diet. So if you don't have enough proteins in the diet, you get a disease called Kwashiorkor. Look at signs of Kwashiorkor. Somebody who has Kwashiorkor, which signs do they have? Signs of Kwashiorkor. Signs of Kwashiorkor. One, brown hair. Brown hair. Number two, swollen moon face. Swollen moon face. Three, swollen stomach. Then we have swollen joints. Swollen joints. Number five, we have swollen arms or hands and legs, they swell. Swollen legs and hands. Swollen legs and hands. So those are signs of Kwashiorkor. Brown hair, swollen moon face, swollen stomach, swollen joints, and swollen legs and hands. How can we prevent Kwashiorkor? Kwashiorkor can be prevented by eating foods rich in proteins. Kwashiorkor can be prevented by eating food rich in proteins. Kwashiorkor and be prevented by eating food rich in proteins. Kwashiorkor can be prevented by eating food rich in proteins. That's how we can prevent kwashiorkor. Then we look at marasmus. Marasmus is caused by lack of carbohydrates. Lack of carbohydrates in the diet. Marasmus is caused by lack of carbohydrates in the diet. Then look at signs of marasmus. Signs of marasmus. Signs of marasmus. 1. The face looks like that of an elderly person. The face of a child looks like that of an elderly person. The face of a child looks like that of an elderly, like that of an elderly person. Like, for example, you have a child, but he looks like a man who is 100 years. Then we have pot belly stomach. The stomach will be like a pot. That's why it's called pot belly stomach. Then number 3, bright white eyes. The eyes will be bright and white. Bright white eyes. Then, and the child becomes an underweight. The child is underweight or emaciation. The child becomes underweight. Lose a lot of weight. The child becomes underweight or the child loses a lot of weight. The child loses a lot of weight or becomes underweight. How can you prevent marasmus? Marasmus can be prevented by eating food rich in carbohydrates like maize, rice, osho, and so on. Millet, sorghum. When you eat those foodstuffs, you get matoke, you get carbohydrates which help to prevent marasmus. Envy. Marasmus can be prevented Arrhythmias can be prevented. Arrhythmias can be prevented by eating food rich in carbohydrates. Arrhythmias can be prevented by eating food rich in carbohydrates. I've given examples like millet, sorghum, rice, osho, maize, and so on, wheat. Then we look at another disease called scurvy. Look at scurvy. Scurvy is caused by lack of vitamin C. Scurvy is caused by lack of vitamin C in the diet. Scurvy is caused by lack of vitamin C in the diet. Look at signs of scurvy. This question came in PLE last year. Signs of scurvy. Signs of scurvy. One, bleeding gums. Bleeding gums. You have bleeding gums. Even the teeth fall off. Then we have poor healing of wounds. Poor healing of wounds. Wounds take long to heal. Poor healing of wounds. If you have wounds, they don't heal. Then the teeth fall off from your mouth. Falling of the teeth. The teeth fall off from the gum. And how can you prevent scurvy? Scurvy can be prevented. Scurvy can be prevented by eating food rich. Eating food rich in vitamin C, like oranges, lemon, those ones are rich in vitamin C. They can help to prevent a scurvy. So that marks the end of our lesson. May the Almighty God bless you abundantly.